land. We couldn't come, unfortunately, but we were fortunate enough that Angelo Rosa from SISA and Mario Nicodemi from the University of Naples agreed to step in. And so they will give us a course on polymer physics with application to chromosome. So,
yeah, thank you. A good job.
Yeah, Dwarfs, can you hear me? Yes. Okay, so welcome, everyone. Sorry, just to the sheet with the present. Okay, maybe you'll give it to me later. So, as Matteo said, my name is Angelo Rosa. I am a researcher in SISA. You will see SISA so this Friday. This is a picture of Piazza Unità d'Italia, you already know probably, a few years ago. And I just give you a short introduction of our group, I mean, of the group whom I belong to in SISA. It's the group of molecular and statistical biophysics. The main focus of this group is to study, biomolecular systems. And we study basically all the realm of molecular, of biomolecules, like proteins, DNA, RNA, and chromosomes. So you will see more about chromosomes during this class. So why I introduce the group is because if any one of you is interested, there will be soon the admission to our PhD in Physics and Chemistry of Biological Systems. This is the official name. Where we apply tools of statistical mechanics or computational physics to study those molecules that I mentioned to you before. So the deadline to apply for the entrance examination is quite tight, unfortunately. It's next week, is 12th of March. In general, it works, there is an exam, so the exam is divided in a written part, and then if you pass the written part, there is the oral part. So if you want more details, you can just look at the webpage. If you feel you are interested but you think maybe you are not in time for this time, there will be a next session this September. If we don't cover all the places that we make available now. So that depends if we don't fill all the places because we don't have enough candidates. The people will not be admitted because they failed the exam. So please, if you are interested, please have a look. And Giovanni Bussi will tell you more about the research topics on Friday for the people who will go to SISA. So this was just to tell you, especially because, the deadline for applying is very close. So that's why I mentioned to you now. So this about that's all about self-promotion, let's say. So, and I will start about these lectures. So as Matteo told you, these lectures are about polymer physics of chromosome folding. So this is a relatively, new subject of research. Not polymer physics is very old, but the application of polymer physics to chromosomes is relatively new. And I will tell you now why. So we'll present first with a few slides. I will tell you about some very soft biological introductions. I understand that can be difficult for physicists. I'm a physicist as well, and I know very little about biology, so it's very complicated. But I will tell you about the phenomenology, in order that you can understand what I will tell you later. Then, since the lectures are about polymer physics of chromosome folding, and I'm pretty sure probably none of you knows about polymer physics because it's a subject that is normally not taught in normal courses at university. I will tell you about generic polymer physics, generic modeling at the blackboard. So I will tell you about theory. So the only background that is required is some very basic statistical mechanics. Nothing more profound than that. And then there will be more focused lectures next week, three lectures, by Professor Mario Nicodemi of from the University of Naples. Mario will tell you about more, new experiments on chromosomes to analyze the chromosome structure, the nuclear structure, and it will tell you also about modeling. Hmm? But in order to understand those modeling, that modeling, you need the polymer physics. So that's the purpose of my lectures. And this is a bunch of references. So the first two references are about polymer physics. So the first one is a very classical one. It's written, it was written by Lifshitz, the famous Lifshitz, Alexander Grossberg and Alexei Kokhlov. It was published, as you can see, almost 40 years ago. So the subject is, as you can see, is not really new, and it's about statistical mechanics of polymers with excluded volume interactions. So you will find also something about field theory. So for the ones of you that are more skilled or more interested in the things like topology in soft matter or renormalization group, this is a very good reference. It's very broad and very interesting. Still nowadays it's very, very interesting and very profound. I really like it. Then there is this more very recent, it was just published last December, references on pedagogical introduction to polymer conformation. Is more similar to what I'm going to tell you now. It's a brilliant review. I really suggest it because it covers a lot of topics. You find a lot of references. It does not cover polymer dynamics, only polymer conformation, so polymers at equilibrium, but different kind of polymers, so linear polymer, ring polymers, polymer with different architectures, and it's very interesting. And it's also mainly devoted to physicists, so it's about physical modeling. Then the rest of these references is about applications of polymer physics to chromosomes. So this is a very small selection. Now, you can find many more. So this one, again by Shura Grossberg, the same Grossberg of here, but 40 years, a bit 40 years later. He explained to you, the effect of topology for the description of chromosomes. Why the effect of topology between different polymer chains is important to understand how chromosomes behave in the nuclei of the cell. Is more. It's a review more for physicists than biologists, I would say, because it's quite it's a bit technical, but it's very interesting. But it also talks about experimental results, so it's a very nice reading. So this review is by myself and a researcher in Paris, Christoph Zimmer. This is very pedagogical. Is basically there is no math there, but it's more. In fact, it was more for biologists, and it's about to explain the different polymer models that were proposed in the literatures up to 2014. I would say that it's already a bit outdated in a sense because it's a very fast growing field. So there are new models that appear in the very last years. And then the rest of those reviews is also about generic polymer modeling for chromosomes. There is a very nice review by Mario Nicodemi, which is more related to his work. So as you can see, it's a very nice subject. And there is a super new review. It was just published 1 month ago in this journal Traffic by Helmut Schissel. Hmm? So. I think, if you want a copy of these slides, you can send to me an email, or I think these lectures are registered, they are recorded, so maybe, if you are interested in reading these papers. So why the problem is timely? Why one should think to apply polymer physics to understand chromosomes? So the fact that now there are a lot of experimental techniques that are applied to investigate the spatial conformations of chromosomes inside the nuclei of the cell. So you probably know that we, I mean, as humans, we belong to some particular realm of, let's say, of living beings. So we are eukaryotes. Eukaryotes means that our cells have a nucleus. Almost all our cells have a nucleus. And inside the nucleus, there are chromosomes. And inside the chromosomes are made by DNA plus some proteins, but basically are made by DNA. And the chromosomes is, the single chromosome is the single structure in which organizes the genome. So all the genome, all our DNA, let's say, is organized in different chromosomes. And chromosomes in the cells can be studied now by different techniques. So the first technique is, this one is called the fluorescence in situ hybridization. It's a very interesting technique. What people do, they can really put fluorescent probes to tag specific portion of the genome. So you can, in order to see them, to see at the microscope. And this is a picture of how a single nucleus, this is a chicken cell. It's a chicken nucleus and chicken form a specific cell line. And this is how chromosome appears. So each chromosome is can be seen according to different colors. So different colors correspond to different chromosomes. This is a nucleus, so it's a very powerful technique. And another technique that is that was proposed only a few years ago is called the chromosome conformation capture. That's why it's called 3C, CCC, CCC. And the chromosome conformation capture technique allows you to measure how frequent chromosomes interact. They are close to each other inside the nucleus of the cells. So they give you quantitative information on the not only on the spatial positioning of the chromosome, but also how frequently you can find, I don't know, chromosome 1 to chromosome 13. And this is important because biologists know now that depending on how chromosomes are localized inside the nucleus of the cell, they can perform or they cannot perform, or they perform in not in the right way their functions inside the cells. And the third technique, so these two techniques actually do not allow to study chromosomes in vivo, let's say to study how chromosomes move, for instance, while this third technique is called you can study chromosome dynamics by using green fluorescent protein. Maybe you have heard of it. That was awarded the Nobel Prize a few years ago. So the idea is that you insert a specific protein, which I think was derived from some jellyfish, inside. So you cut some portion of the genome, you insert these proteins, and then this protein, when it's excited by some light, becomes green, and then you can follow how these things move inside the cell. But since it's attached to a chromosome, what you can see is the dynamics of the chromosome. And you can imagine that you can, for instance, measure the mean square displacement in time of this locus on the chromosome and apply genetic technique like the one, for instance, Langevin equation to model this kind of displacement. And so all these techniques are quantitative, so they give you numbers. And since in the end DNA and then chromosomes are polymers, so it's interesting to see, okay, can I use what I know from polymer physics to understand what I observe from experiments? And the answer is yes, in the sense that polymer physics can tell you a lot about chromosome inside the cells. I will tell you a bit more about it later. First, you have to know polymer physics first to appreciate the results. But just let me conclude with a bit more of phenomenology. So this is a picture, of course, what I'm going to tell you about is generic. It can be called like the problems of chromosome folding. So namely, how chromosomes are organized inside the nucleus of the cell. The nucleus is a very important organelle inside all our cells where chromosomes are contained. So they are physically separated from the rest of the cell. Probably this was due to evolution in order to protect our genome and also the genomes of all the other eukaryotes from being, let's say, dispersed in the cell, because it's protected somehow. Actually, this is a very interesting system for a polymer physicist, because it happens, so you think that each single filament of DNA which belongs to a single chromosome is 1 centimeter in length, while the dimension of the nucleus is only 10 microns. So you can imagine that this poses a very important problem, how chromosomes are packed inside such a tight volume. It poses a very important question. I mean, how they are packed in such a way that they are also efficiently packed in order to, that the information which is contained, I mean, inside the genome can be accessed by all the cellular machinery. And as you can see, I mean, I will show you that this also generates a lot of interesting physics that I will tell you a bit more probably Thursday. After I will tell you about generic polymer physics. So this is the last slide for biology, for the biological point of view. Yes.
So the
yes. So the percentage is not much. It's about 10-20%, because of course, I mean, chromosomes and DNA is very long, but it's also very thin.
Yeah.
So the only percentage of chromosomes, so which I mean by chromosome, the DNA plus the proteins, because it's not only naked DNA, there are also some proteins, actually many proteins. It's about 20%. The rest of the cell is filled with other bodies. The nucleus is filled by other bodies. Also the cell. I mean, the rest of the cell is filled by bodies. But the nucleus is filled by other bodies, and so it's pretty crowded, I would say. And this is in general. I mean, actually eukaryotes all look more or less. They all look the same. We are not so different from fruit fly or even yeast. I mean the Saccharomyces cerevisiae, which is the yeast for the budding yeast for making bread or beer, it's also a eukaryote, and it's actually one of the most studied organisms, and it's quite close to us. I mean, for many things. In spite of its simplicity. Yes, and then this is last slide for biology. Let's say, so this is a bit of generic phenomenology. So the cell cycle. So first of all, almost any cell undergoes a cycle. So namely, during the cycle, the DNA of each cell is replicated, is doubled, in order to form two new cells. So this is pretty common knowledge. I think you know that. So how? And chromosome too. I mean, they do not stay. I mean, they are very dynamic during this cell cycle. Cell cycle can be divided into parts. One part, let's say, broadly speaking, one is mitosis and the other part is interphase. During mitosis, chromosome take this, don't have a pointer, okay, they take this shape that you are probably familiar with. It's like two elongated rods. But during interphase, it's which is the part of the cell that takes most time, I mean, basically, normal cells duplicate into 24 hours, roughly, and 23 hours of these 24 hours are taken by interphase. And during interphase, chromosomes do not take that rod-like shape, but they are more dispersed, let's say, inside the nucleus, and form a particular organization which is called the territorial organization, in sense that each chromosome is dispersed but does not occupy all the nucleus. It occupies a small region of the nucleus, which is called the territory. And that discovery was done about 30 years ago. It was a really fundamental discovery in biology. And I mean, the kind of polymer physics I will tell you about will be in order to understand this peculiar organization of chromosomes inside the cells. So this territorial organization is common. I mean, since basically any organism has it. So it's a very generic feature. And that's quite important that you retain it. And this the picture here, just to conclude that, is about how, I mean, how chromosomes are formed. So chromosomes are formed, as I said, by DNA plus some proteins. And this compound of DNA and protein is called the chromatin. And the chromatin is the main structural unit of the chromosome. So broadly speaking, you have DNA. You have proteins which are called histones. And histones are electrically charged, positively charged. Since DNA is negatively charged, then DNA wraps around these histones, okay? And histones are very important because they contribute to regulate how the DNA, I mean, the genome works. Because when, because of this interaction, the DNA is tightly packed, it cannot be accessed by what are called, for instance, transcription factors. Transcription factors are some proteins that contribute to transcribe the DNA. When it's not so tightly packed, then instead it can be accessed. So, and this structure, this kind of, conformation is very important to understand. It's very important to understand how the genome works. But for time being, I mean, you can more or less forget about it in the sense that you can just retain that chromosomes can be considered like long filaments and basically polymers. So I can close these. I hope it closes, yes. And so we can just start my introduction to polymers. So, first of all, what are polymers? So polymers are long molecules where you have basically one single unit is called a monomer. And this unit is attached one after the other. So a simple example I already mentioned to you of a polymer is DNA. So you have the four bases which are attached one after the other. And the process that contributes to the formation of polymer is called polymerization. And basically it is a process where one monomer attaches one after the other. It's a process that can go on basically forever, in the sense that the kind of interaction. So if you have a single monomer, let's say, and you have which is functional, so they can attach to another monomer, then can go this way, and then so on and so forth. So the DNA is a specific example of linear polymer, in the sense that if you stretch from one end to the other, it's like a strand. I mean, it's a linear strand. But there are other polymers which are not linear. They are called branched polymer. So branched polymer are polymer which are made of units which can be polyfunctional. So, for instance, you can imagine that you attach one monomer here, and then there are two links, no, that favor more the presence of branches. And so, for instance, can go this way, and also they can go on and on forever. And then there is also polymers which are circular, so namely like ring. They are called ring polymers. For instance, in the DNA of prokaryotes, so not eukaryotes, we are eukaryotes, but prokaryotes, for instance, bacteria like E. coli, so the genome of E. coli is a single DNA, formed by one single filament of DNA, which is circular, so it's a ring polymer. So as you can see, they have also some application in biology. So given this kind of very broad introduction. I mean, how physicists have applied their, let's say, their tools to understand polymers. So basically, polymer physics can be divided in two parts. It's like about studying the conformations of polymer at equilibrium, in general, polymers in some solvent, and also studying the dynamics of polymers. So my the first for this lecture, I will tell you about a bit also more a bit about dynamics. But I mean, for to start, I will tell you about polymer conformation at equilibrium. Mm? So one is to imagine like let's say polymers like at equilibrium at some temperature T. So it's like a real statistical mechanics model. I mean, what characterizes polymer? I mean, it's very few things. And one thing is the flexibility. Mm? So imagine just from the abstract point of view that you have a structure like this, one after the other. So what it happens is that these bonds here are not completely rigid. Mm? So they are subject to thermal fluctuation. So in general, the let's say the deviation from so that has some kind of can you see all me from very far? So if you have this is a sort of direction, no, for this bond. So then you have the next bond here. What it happens that at equilibrium the next bond will not have exactly the same direction as the one before, no, but will be a bit on average will be a bit let's say we have a slightly different direction from the previous one, and so on and so forth. Okay. So in the end, I mean, if you have many monomers, and in general for a polymer you have many monomers, because in general, if you call the number of monomers n, what you want, I mean, in general in polymer physics, you study the limit of n, which is much larger than one. So in the end, for very long polymers, you will have a situation where the initial direction of your polymer will be completely forgotten. Hmm? So will be completely decorrelated from the original direction. So that means that, I mean, at the first approximation, the most simple model for a polymer is a model where you have monomers, okay, which I number like I from 0 to n. So I have n plus 1 monomers linked one after the other by rigid bonds. Okay. And so it's 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, n minus 1, and n. I imagine that, as a first approximation, I imagine that the direction of this bond is completely decorrelated from the direction of this bond. So they are free to rotate around this hinge. And so for the rest. And I call the length of this bond B. In general, in the literature, you can find B on, or you can find also another notation, but I'll stay simply on with this notation B. And this is the length of the bond, which is fixed. I take it as fixed. Then I will a bit relax this constraint. And then what I ask is how, so first of all, I want to ask about conformation. So of course, I mean, this is a kind of, this is one single conformation, but as I told you, polymers are free to move in the environment. So in the end, what I'm interested in is the typical size of the polymer as a function of the number of monomers. I mean, why this? Because I mean, it can be shown that the typical size of my polymer that, now I will be more precise, but in general, the typical size of the polymer grows as a power law of the number of monomers. So there is a scaling behavior. Hmm? And this is generic for any polymer model. No, it's if you stretch stretch conformation is one particular conformation. I'm taking all possible conformation. So this is an average, if you want. Okay, maybe I put an average over all possible conformation. So this is a rigid bond, and they are free to rotate. So I'm taking an average of all possible conformation in space for this ensemble. They are all, and I also assume Okay, so this is the generic modeling. I also assume now that there are no volume interaction between different monomers, namely any monomer can overlap with any other monomer, which is of course not physical, but I mean, in some cases it's a good approximation. And that's it. And for the rest, these bonds are rigid and they are free to rotate. So in this bond here, it's free to rotate around this hinge. So it takes an all spatial conformation. It's clear? It's very simple. And in general, this, so I remove this average here because I will be more precise on the definition of the observables. In general, the typical size of the polymer grows as a power law of its components. And the first, let's say, task we are going to face is to determine for this specific model, I mean, what is nu? Okay, in general, this problem is very simple. I mean, you can see that it's a bit simple for the following reason. That imagine that, okay, I take the first bond, sorry, the first bead, the first monomer here as fixed in space because, I mean, of course, it doesn't matter where the absolute position of the polymer in space. And then, of course, I mean, if I say that this thing, I mean, this bond can stay here, then the next one can be everywhere and so on and so forth. This is very similar to what you have for a model for a random walk, right? I mean, random walk not in time as the typical random walk, but a random walk in space. Okay, so imagine that you have something that sits here, then these things can take any possible direction and so on and so forth, then this is like a kind of a model for a random walk. But we'll derive, now things in a rigorous way. So there are two quantities that typically people study for this model. So in general, to study the overall size, one quantity is the so-called average square end-to-end distance. So namely, you have, so this is the vector that points to monomer zero, and this is the vector that points to monomer n, and this is some frame, the origin of the frame. So then, what I'm going to compute is this quantity. And this is defined as, I called it R0. So this is R1, and this is Rn, okay? So that's the vector that points from the origin of the frame to the bead. So this is Rn minus R0 square average. So you can ask why I took square and then I average. I could take just Rn minus R0 average. Of course, that will give you zero because any direction is possible. So by symmetry, that gives you zero. So I need some quantity that is positive definite. It's definite positive. So this is the standard quantity that people takes into account. And so now this quantity is very simple to calculate actually, because now I introduce vectors. I mean, I introduce the bond vectors, t like t1, t2, etc. And these vectors are defined like ti is equal by definition to ri plus one. Sorry, r I minus R I minus 1 for I going from 0 to n minus 1. I have, of course, n bond vectors and n plus 1 position. Okay? So this is very advantageous if I introduce this quantity because now. Finish the space. So because now this quantity R square EE, this can be simply defined like RN minus R0, this is just the sum for I that goes from 1 to n of ti.
You see that, no? Because this is just the difference between the last vector and the first vector position, and then this is just the sum of all bond vectors. Okay. Sorry. Oh. Yes. I should take off the project. Yes. Good question. How to do that? Off. Yes. Yes. Maybe. It's a bad. Okay, let me. No, at all. So this way. From one to n. Yes. And then so that goes like sum. So this is exact. So if I introduce this thing here. So this is the sum I from one to n of ti. Square. And now I can. So this is just equal to sum I and j from 1 to n ti scalar product tj. And I can put this sum outside. Maybe I write it here because otherwise probably you can't see. Okay. And so this becomes like sum I and j from 1 to n ti scalar tj. And now you just average. So now you can see that what you need to do is you just distinguish between the terms where I is equal to j and when I is different from j. So this is just the sum I from 1 to n of t square, okay, plus twice the sum where I is from 1 to n minus 1 and j from I plus 1 and n. Ti scalar tj, average, okay? But now you can see that that's very easy to do because all ti have the same length by construction. As I told you, they are all equivalent. And so this is just b squared times n. Plus the cross, plus the average of the cross correlation, let's say, between bond I and bond j. But since they are all independent, this is just zero. Okay? So in the end, plus zero. And so in the end, this quantity is just equal to b squared n. And if you compare with this formula here, you see that my exponent nu, my ratitia nu, is equal to 1 half. So which is, if you, as I said, if you are familiar, if you are familiar with the random walk, this is just like a random walk, okay, in space. Is it clear? You have a question? Yes. Yeah.
For that reason, we can eliminate this
term,
right?
Yeah, they are independent, so we can eliminate this term.
How we can consider that these chains mm-hmm. attached, if we consider these independent, there is a potential or something like that?
I will tell you a bit more later about how to do that. In general, this thing is non-zero.
Yeah.
So there are different possibilities. Either, okay, first, for this model, which is, okay, this model is called, I didn't mention that, it's called the freely jointed, or freely rotating, it depends, sometimes from the book, freely jointed chain, FJC. And this is very, the most simple model, the most simple model for a polymer chain. So the assumption of this model is that this term is goes to zero. And this, of course, the simplest assumption you can take. But then you can have another assumption where this correlation is non-zero. And probably I will tell you a bit more tomorrow. I don't think I have the time today. And if it's non-zero, then you develop correlation. But then you need to see how this correlation behave as a function of the distance of the bond vectors along the chain.
So I can tell you that if these correlations are, let's say, are, for instance, exponentially damped, so namely they are very short range, then you have still the law of the random walk on very long scale. So in general, you can renormalize everything if you want, and then you get something which is similar to a random walk. So it's again a random walk. But if these correlations are long range, then you need to see, there can be correction to this linear term, and in general can is determined that the correction are no problem. And then then the corrections to the linear term are larger. Actually, not correction, but they give this correlation. They give a more important term than the linear one. Other question? Okay. So if there are no questions, so this is the first result that you need to retain. So I will put it here. This is exact. It's very simple. It's like a random walk with a fixed jump. Okay. No, there is no approximation here. Is exact. Can be a mean field if I make if I introduce a model with some, I don't know, volume interaction, and then. But the new is not. So. I see what you mean. So if you want, yes, this is equivalent like a mean field approximation, yes, for a polymer. Yeah, okay, I see. But we'll discuss a deviation from this model. So I presume this is very simple, so I can be fast on it. So this is the first result. So for a model, let's say, in general, this is always true. So for a model, for a polymer model with a very long polymer, without excluded volume interaction, the typical size goes like B, N to the 1/2. And I let you notice one thing which is very important, that this result does not depend on the dimension. Okay, I listen to me, they're talking a bit too much, sorry. I mean, if you have a question, ask, sorry. No, otherwise it's a bit difficult to me to keep the attention. This result does not depend on dimension. Because in the end of what I did, I never used the fact that we are in 3D or 2D or 1D, whatever. So that holds everywhere. So we will see that when we introduce volume interaction, then there will be an effect which depends on dimension, on the exponent nu. So the fact now that I can use, I have a law which is completely related to the law of the random walk, allows me to also to discuss not only the average, so this is basically the average size of my polymer chains. But what if I want to discuss not only the average properties, but also, the properties which also deviate a little bit from the average one, then I can ask what is not only the average value of this of the polymer, but what is the average distribution? For the values of these, for instance, of the end to end distance. And this is simple to derive. Since I told you that this is very similar, this is basically the same the same math of a random walk, then one can ask what is the typical distribution of the size of my polymer. And the typical distribution of the size of my polymer, if this is basically the same mathematics of the random walk, it will be like a Gaussian. You know about this that distribution of the end, let's say, of the of the distances that can that a random walk can perform is a Gaussian, right? So that means the following, that the distribution of my end-to-end distance is, so namely, if the end for the end-to-end distance of a polymer being R, this is this quantity, so it's 2 pi n d square d over 2, the exponential of minus d r square of n 2 n d square. Yes.
What is the subscript in the R first? Probability of R.
So this is the probability that the end-to-end distance takes a value R. So distribution, probability distribution. This is given by this formula.
What is the subscript?
Which subscript?
E.
In the end-to-end distance, sorry. It's the same as before. Okay? Yeah, this is, if I ask, what is the probability distribution that my polymer has an end-to-end distance of length R, so it's in this direction, this is the distribution, okay? And this is can be derived exactly, now I'll tell you, I mean, how you can derive it. Just I'll give you the first passages. Otherwise, I don't have the time to go to give you more details on the rest. But the shape is like is the one of a Gaussian, because this is exactly the same. Because this is linked to the similarity between a polymer chains with no excluded volume without excluded volume interaction as and the random walk. So it's a Gaussian. Yes. Yes, this one?
This is something from experiment.
No, it's not experiment. It's the from the model. Okay, you can find also. No, I said that it provides. So you have this model. So the model is the following. You have a collection of monomers linked one after the other. So it's the most simple model that you can have for a polymer, for a linear polymer. So you have a monomer, one after the other, right? And then I have no correlations between consecutive direction, right? So that means that the typical size of my object grows as the square root of its component, of the total number of components, which is the same as a random walk. So then, okay, I forgot to mention this. So this results first does not depend on the dimension of my system. So namely, this depends. It's the same that you are in 3-dimension, 4-dimension, infinite dimension, well, yeah, any possible dimension, okay? So then I ask, what is the, not all, so this is the average value, the average size of my polymer. So then I ask, because I need this expression later, so what is the typical distribution of these sizes, of the size of my polymer? And the typical distribution is a Gaussian, and sorry, I forgot, D is the dimension of my space. So the distribution, let's say, has a dependence on the dimension, on this prefactor here. And you can see that this distribution is in line with these results, because if you calculate R square on this distribution, that gives you N B square, okay? Because the variance here is N B square. Okay, so this is the typical distribution of the sizes of an ideal, let's say it's called an ideal polymer, ideal because I have no excluded volume interaction. Okay, so it's very simple. Okay, so now, because I want to tell you a bit more on, so now, how you, for instance, so this can be an exercise you can do yourself, but I will tell you how you can derive this formula, because it's quite instructive. And you can derive it in that way. So you furl, we can stay in 3D, but in the other, I mean, in different dimension is the same. So in order to derive it, so you have to calculate the average value of Rn minus R0 minus R. So this is the average value of this delta function. So this delta function blocks, no, the end-to-end distance to stay equal to R. Okay, and then you have to calculate the average value of this delta function on all possible, so given, let's say, all possible conformations of my polymer. Okay, and so this average is done on by using the following weight. So this is equal to the integral delta Rn minus R0 minus R. So then I have to define, let's say, the weight for my chains, but that you know, because as I told you, so the only constraint for the chain is that the bonds are fixed and that the bonds are free to rotate. Mm? So then the physical, let's say, the Boltzmann weight for my chain is, take you this, not to avoid mistakes, is given by the product from I to 1 to n of dt 4 pi b square delta function ti minus b. So, so this is dti. So basically, so this is very simple not to describe. So you have that each bond is independent from the other, and each bond has a fixed length. So this is just the delta function. So this is a product of delta function, where each delta function, it imposes that the length of the bond is fixed, and that integral is the integral over, over all these. The dti, so where the ti is the direction of the bond. Is it clear, the shape of this weight? No. So you have so each bond is independent from the other. I mean, as any possible direction, right? So if and then each bond has a fixed length. So you have to imagine like it's a rod in space that is free to rotate. And they are all independent. So this is just the product of all this thing, right? And you have to put, so 4 pi b squared is to make this weight, this is just the normalization of this statistical weight. And then I have to do the product of all possible directions. Is it clear or no? Yes, no? So... So you have, okay, let's say the fact. So each bond lives on a sphere, right? Oh, sorry, on the surface of the sphere, because it's fixed, right? So you have your chain. So each bond is in the direction of each bond. First of all, each bond has a fixed length, right? And then the direction of each bond is independent of the rest, right? So then I can write this as a product of all possible bonds. Because that's the weight of statistical weight of my chain, right? Maybe you can tell me what's not clear. Yes. This is in 3D, yeah, I told you, no? I'm doing the calculation D equal 3, yes. Sorry, say again. No, but this one is the dt, the integral. And this is a delta function that imposes that the bond has the length b. Each bond has a length b. Okay? So then, is it more clear? Yes.
One question.
Oh, if you want, yes. See, see, but it's more complicated if you think in this term.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, this is just, I mean, if you have, suppose that you don't have this, so you don't have the delta function. So this is just a collection of n roads, independent roads. And then and then it gives you just, if you make the integral, this is just one, okay? So it's very simple. It's nothing. So then, in order to, if you want, in order to, so then now I'm fixing the end-to-end distance to be equal to r, okay? So then, in order to calculate, to derive the end-to-end distribution, so to make this integral, what you do, you, first of all, you resort to the Fourier representation for the this delta function. So you write this thing like dk over 2 pi cube, the e to the I k rn minus r0 minus r. Okay? So this is the 3D representation of delta function in terms of I mean, the Fourier representation for a delta function, okay?
That's exponential.
E to the I, yes. You know this, no? Yeah, sorry. Yeah, exponential of I, well, I think it's clear, no? Well, hope so. Okay.
Similar to
well.
No.
This one? Yes, it's the yeah. Okay. But well, it's similar to what? This I don't understand. No. Okay. Okay, maybe I'm. I mean, I don't write very well. I don't know. So this is just it's the Fourier. But you know that, no? The Fourier representation of the delta function, right? So then, what you do? You insert this representation here. Okay. So let me because the blackboard is not enormous, so I introduce it here. Sorry. So I want to show you how they can derive. So this is dk 2 pi cube e to the I k dot r n minus r0 minus r. Okay? And then there is this thing here. And so then what I do, I switch the two integrals. So I move this outside and this inside. So this is equal to dk over 2 pi cube. This is e to the I, of course, k, times rn minus r0 minus r. Times this thing, pi I equal to n dti divided by 4 pi b square delta ti minus b. Okay, and now it's, forgot anything, no. Yes, and then you have this integral that is made on this term here, okay? So now what you do, you write this thing, rn minus r0, like the sum from I to n of ti. I mean, because this is just by construction, right? And so that means the following, that this thing is the integral in dk. You can put outside the term with e to the minus i k R, because it does not depend on this term. And this is the integral pi I 1 n dt I divided by 4 pi b square delta t I minus b, and you can see that e to the called it I k dot t I, okay, because this is a sum, so this is the exponential of I k times the sum of these, and so this so each TI is independent from the other, so I can put it, I can reframe like this. And this is nothing that is a very simple integral, because since each TI is independent from the others, this is just the integral on each T, 4 pi b square, delta T minus b, e to the I k t, and this to the power of n, because each t is independent from the others, okay? And so this integral is very easy to do. Actually, it's exact. You can do it yourself. I just give you the solution. So this integral here.
I finish the space.
It's the sine of kb divided by kb. Okay? You can see it from very far away. So the so that if you do this this integral, that gives you this sine over. Sorry, it's sine, yes, sine of kb divided by kb. So then, so up to now, this formula is exact, so I've made no approximation, okay? So now what you need to do is, it's a very simple approximation, because you can observe the following thing, that this term here, it's always smaller than one, okay? And since it's always smaller than one, and you have a term which is smaller than one to a power law of n, and then, as I told you, is typically very large, because polymers in general have very big n. So then you can just, you can think that the terms that contribute to this integral are the ones where kb is very close to zero. Okay, so this is like 1 minus kb over square over 6. So this is the Taylor expansion for this term. And then you so you insert this term here. So this is like 1 minus kb square over 6. This is an approximation. And then you make this term, you make, let's see, another, I mean, yet another approximation, because you say that this term, 1 minus kb square over 6 to the n, is like, sorry, I don't know how to write it. I write it here. So this is just like the approximately the exponential of minus n kb square over 6. So you can see it has the same Taylor expansion of this thing. And now it's you are done, because now what you have to do, you just the integral, let's say it's like the Fourier transformation of the of an exponential, of a, sorry, of a Gaussian, which is also a Gaussian, of course, you know that. No, it's this one, It's approximately, sorry. You have difficulty understanding the notation, sorry. So it's approximately the exponential of this thing. And then what you need to do is just the integral. So this Fourier integral for in 3D of the exponential, which is also of the Gaussian, which is also a Gaussian. And that gives you the formula for the Gaussian function that gives you the end-to-end distribution function of an ideal polymer. And you can do the same thing in any dimension you want. Again, I have not, so I did it in three dimensions, but in any dimension, it's doable. It's clear, this the way I did it? So there is, as I told you, before doing this expansion, the formula is exact. After doing this expansion, the formula is no longer exact, of course. And you can see why it's no longer exact. Sorry? Yes?
Just trying to come back to the first Gaussian that you showed for D-divisions.
Yes.
And it's a Gaussian that goes B squared, and the other one was B squared minus D minus 2 instead of B2.
No, so you mean before I did this?
Yeah, it's supposed to get to the Gaussian in three dimensions that you showed before for D-dimensional.
Yes, and because the dimensionality is here.
Okay.
Okay. So this is well, it's here and here too, because here you have this thing. Otherwise, you would have a different weight here if you are in a different dimension. You are not. For instance, in two dimensions, it will be like 2 pi b, you know? This is 4 pi b squared, this is in three dimensions, right?
Okay.
So I derived, so this derivation holds for three dimensions, okay? So I will probably, okay, tomorrow, because I have some notes, I will give you okay, I will send you the page for the notes, I will show you the, but the calculation in the end is very simple. So now that you have this, you can put this formula here, and you do this integral. I mean, you can try yourself. You do this integral back, and you get precisely the formula for the end-to-end distribution function of a Gaussian chain in three dimensions. I mean, the formula that I showed you before. And so you can see, you can see why the formula is approximated. Okay, let's take just some space here. So where is the apparently the calculation, okay, of course there is the approximation, but where it's more evident, this approximation? So the approximation is more evident here. So I write it again, E equal to R. So the formula, so I write it in three dimensions, no? For my Gaussian. Okay, and so where is the approximation? The approximation, can be seen here, because this formula tells you that I can stretch my polymer to any extent, and still the distribution of my distance is non-zero, okay? But we started from a model where the bonds are rigid, so if I stretch it, enough, then of course I cannot reach any possible distance for the end-to-end. When it's over, completely stretched, it will be like the end-to-end distance will be n times b, okay? But the maximum distance from this formula is not limited. So at full extension n b, the probability for this end-to-end distance will be exponentially small, but will be non-zero. And this is a consequence of this approximation here. So the distribution is, approximately Gaussian, but it's not exactly Gaussian. But you can verify, for instance, you can simulate you can simulate just a random walk on a lattice, for instance. You can verify that the Gaussian approximation It's a very good approximation, provided that the number of components of your polymer is large enough. So this approximation is very useful, and we will keep it from now on. Okay. And another, so you can try to do this calculation. And another important properties of these that has some connection actually to chromosomes, because I mentioned to you that there exist now these experiments where people are able to measure contacts between, let's say, parts of the chromosome on the cells, is that the probability, so this is called the ring closure probability, the probability that the end-to-end distance is equal to zero, this is, of course, this is simple, no? You just put R0 here. This is just 3 over 2 pi nb square 3 over 2. So which means that the probability of, it's called the ring closure probability or cyclization probability, goes like n to the minus 3 over 2. And this is a specific feature of the Gaussian model. If you want, if you want to generalize to the dimension, this goes like n to the minus d over 2 in the dimension. Okay, and we will see that if you introduce, so this is a very specific property of a Gaussian polymer, because if we introduce excluded volume interaction, in our, let's say, if we consider a more realistic model for a polymer, this is no longer true. Okay, and this is a property that actually is measured in chromosomes, and people see that they do not belong, they do not behave as Gaussian polymer. Actually, they are quite different. And so, just by looking at this exponent in chromosomes, they can. People can develop different kind of modeling. So it's quite an important feature. Yes, please. To the ring closure probability. So you ask, what is the probability that the two ends clamp close? You can close the polymer. Is it like the same as return probability in a random walk language? No, no, but this is not the average radius. I agree with you, totally agree with you, it's not zero. It's just, this is, would be just the radius of a ring polymer, of an ideal ring polymer with no excluded volume interaction, which is actually not very different from a linear polymer. It has the same power law behavior, like it's n to the 1 over 2. It's with a different prefactor, but the scaling dependent is the same. But this is not the average size of a ring polymer. This is the probability that a linear polymer, the two ends of a linear polymer, goes together as a function of the number of components. And it's exactly the same as the return probability, yes. And in the dimension, I mean, it's very easy to generalize. It's just d over 2. Very simple. and so now, sorry. No, I think I will. Yeah, I think I have time. But what time is it now? Sorry. Okay, no, set it down. I started at 2:30, right? Okay, so now we want to have a more realistic. So this is a very. This is the starting starting point of a polymer. Oh, okay, first of all, one thing that I let you notice, which can be very useful before going to show you how you can generalize to by introducing excluded volume effect, is the following. So, actually, this, in spite of its simplicity, in these, these properties, it's very. It tells you a lot. So, suppose that, okay, first of all, it teaches also how to coarse grain polymers in this way. Suppose that, again, you have your freely jointed chain.
Okay, very long. And that you take, so you said, okay, I'm not interested in local scales. I want a model which is more, which is called coarse grain. Hmm? These are typical things that people in polymer physics do. So what I imagine that I consider, let's say, a super monomer, which, let's say, I divide my polymer into subsection, and this subsection has some size, which is schematized by this, let's say, super monomer, and this one after the other, and so on and so forth. Okay. Now, this formula, so supposing, suppose that the number of monomers here is sufficiently large. Hmm? So this formula tells me how I can coarse grain the model, because basically the average size of this, let's say, super monomer, it's also described according to this distribution, okay? Because any subsection of this model, it's like an independent model from the rest, because as I said, the junction here are independent, okay? So that means that suppose that I call n small the number of monomers that are contained inside this super monomer, then the size, the distribution of the size of this super monomer, which I call the small r, let's say, it's given precisely by this quantity, okay? And then the model that I can consider here, let's say this with this more coarse-grained, we need this more coarse-grained approach, it's a model where I have a collection of monomer linked by elastic springs. You see that because it's like an elastic potential, roughly. Hmm? Yeah, so up to here is clear? Yes. Okay, so I repeat this. So as I said, suppose that you consider, let's say that you divide your polymer into a collection of n subchains, where each subchain has small n monomers. So then I have, if you want, I have n, I don't know how to call it, m, I call it m, the number of, let's say, of super monomers. This is equal to capital N divided by small n. Hmm? And so then what I want is a description in terms of m of these spheres, let's say. So then I say, since each part, each of this subchain is also, I mean, of course, is a chain in itself, hmm? So it's also subjected to thermal fluctuation, then the typical size of each one of these subchain has to go like this way, no? Because it's just because they are all independent, so each subportion has to follow the same law. Hmm? Yes. But no, it has to be much smaller, I would say. No, it has to be, so let's say n, capital N has to be much larger than 1, n has to be much larger than 1, and if you want, this is not really necessary, but you can take capital N much small, much larger than n as well, so. We always work in this limit, I mean, where polymers are very long, I mean, we don't want a finite size effect. Hmm? And so then, since each one of these monomers is, let's say, you can imagine too now that you get rid of the, let's say, the small scale details, hmm? And you center, you take the center of your super monomer and you connect to the next center and so on and so forth. So then, this bond is fluctuating according to this law. The center of the circle, yeah, roughly. Yeah. You can consider the center of mass, for instance, yes. Oh, yeah.
What did I change? Sorry. The
R in the exponent.
No, no. I said this is the size of one of these super monomers. Okay. So, so this is a way, and because this allows me to introduce what actually is used more in polymer physics, which is the Gaussian chain. So Gaussian chain is basically a model where you have, it's similar to the free joint chain, but now you don't have anymore a collection of rigid bonds, but you have a collection of springs, because this is like, it's like a model with springs. Yes.
That one is the rule for the linear size of each super monomer.
Yes.
So how did we come to the spring
collecting? But simply because you can center this thing here, right? So then the monomers which are comprised between these two centers. Oh, yeah. Between these two centers, which are, I mean, the center of these monomers comprised by n small n monomers. As fluctuation, they have to be the same fluctuation as this one. So just to give you a flavor, I mean, of how you can proceed to coarse grain, then to have a more generalized model than the free Jundin chain. Because the free Jundin chain is okay, but has this constraint of having fixed bond, so you cannot really work with it. So it's in general, in polymer physics, people work not with rigid bonds, but with the springs. So in general, you have a collection of consecutive monomers connected by entropic springs, if you want, which come precisely from the Gaussian distribution of the end-to-end distance, which is approximately Gaussian in the case of free Jundin chain, but is for a Gaussian chain is exact actually. Okay. Yes. This one?
Yes.
Okay, maybe this would be your R. No, okay, but you see. Yes.
Sorry, it's not the end-to-end distance.
If you want, it's the end-to-end distance between two centers. Yes. But we can write it small R, yeah. And so now, because I wanted to, so I went a bit fast here because I want to introduce the more realistic model. So suppose, again, the first feature, the most important feature for an ideal polymer is that the end-to-end distance, the typical size, grows as the square root of n, and as I told you, we can define another observable, which is the, which I would call the ring closure probability. I can call it like PC of N. That goes like N to the minus 3/2 in three dimension. So this is this probability that a polymer make a ring. Or if you want, in the dimension, V/2, okay? So now, what it happens if we have, yes?
This probability is permitted to have the chain as a
ring? No, this is the probability, what is the probability that given the free ends of a polymer chain, I can make a ring. Okay. So if you want, this introduces another exponent, which is a bit less traditional in polymer physics, but is another, let's say, scaling exponent. It tells you that it's power law, which is some of you observed is just the return probability. But it's, as I said, it's very important because it's a relationship with chromosomes. And I think Mario next week will tell you a lot about that. So suppose that now we have as I said, this model is so this is in the dimension. So this model is okay. I mean, as far as we can neglect excluded volume interaction, but of course this is first of all, this is not granted, and second, I mean, we have excluded volume interaction in polymer. So that means that you have a polymer where two monomers, when because of the thermal fluctuation, when they go close in space, they do not like each other simply because they cannot stay on top of each other, and so they repel each other. So how, and I mean, if, I mean, how this law and also this one changes because of the presence of the excluded volume interaction. So this is a very important problem. And actually, this problem cannot be solved exactly. And so one has to do some approximation. So you have your polymer, right? So actually I made a very important approximation that you have, let's say, two monomers that can occupy any position in the space, which is of course not realistic, no? Because monomers repel each other, right? For instance, if you have, any kind of polymer, DNA, whatever. So if you have a long enough filament of DNA inside the nucleus, for instance, you cannot find that the same, base can stay on top of another base. So there are effective excluded volume repulsion, no? Between different monomers on your polymer chain. And that has very deep influence on the sides of the polymer in general. So what I want to do is to calculate how excluded volume interaction influence the typical sides of the polymer. Again, I let you notice that this law does not depend on the space dimension, but now we will see that if we introduce excluded volume interaction, actually, now we will have an exponent which depends indeed on the dimension of the space where the polymer lives. So unfortunately there is no exact treatment of excluded volume interaction for polymer. So one has to do some simplification, and the more general the more simple theory that allows you to calculate exponent for the polymer is the so-called Flory theory. That was formulated by Flory, I think, in the 50s, probably, yes. So the Flory theory is very simple, and the idea is the following. You define an effective free energy of your system, and of course the free energy will be given in terms of an energetic term that takes into account excluded volume interaction between the monomers of your polymer, and an entropy, okay? Right? And this is the temperature. So this is the general idea. So then this is an effective free energy. So this effective free energy will be a function of the typical size of my polymer. So the energetic term, and so the entropy. So then by minimizing this function, I will get the typical size of a polymer as a function of the number of monomers. Ah, yes, that will be also, of course, write it again. So that will be a function of N and R, and this will be a function of N and R minus TS of N and R, okay? And now the task is how I can calculate, estimate, whatever, I mean, you can, these two quantities. So I need an estimate for E and an estimate for S. Okay, is it clear, the problem?
And then by minimizing this effective free energy, I will get, let's say, possibly I will get the answer to my problem. So this is the task. And how Flory did, I mean, it was in a very clever and in the end, it's a very, very simple way. So of course, I mean, we will play with the most simple of these problems. So namely, when we have a monomer, I mean, we have an homopolymer. So I mean, an homopolymer, I mean a polymer where all monomers are the same. And where the two monomers, I mean, anytime two monomers come close into each other, they just repel, they don't like. So it's a kind of situation which, in polymer language is called when a polymer is embedded in a good solvent. So a polymer typical, of course, is not free. I mean, it's always in some solvent. So some solvent means that you have molecules around. So meaning in good solvents, what does it mean in good solvent? In good solvent means that the polymer likes more, the monomers of the polymer, likes more to interact with the solvent than with itself. And that basically is the same as introducing an effective repulsion between the monomers of the polymer, right? Good solvent, yes. The opposite is in bad solvent, meaning that the polymer does not like too much the solvent. It's like, for instance, the polymer is, when you have an hydrophobic polymer in water, for instance, tend to compact, right, to shrink, yes. But we'll treat first, we can do also Flory theory for in the case of bad solvent, but first we do it in a good solvent, which is the simplest case, actually. So how we determine these two terms? Okay, first of all we do the entropy because it's simpler. And the entropy, actually, it's simpler for the following reason, because Flory, Flory made a very simple assumption. So he said, okay, I neglect correlations in my polymer chain. So of course, I mean, because I introduce exclusive volume effect, there are strong correlations between monomers. But I said, no, okay, I neglect this correlation. And I assume, but this is a very strong hypothesis, it's an hypothesis that one has to verify a posteriori, right? So I assume that my entropy is just described by the, so it's, would be, if you want, it would be the logarithm of some quantity, and let's say of the number of states of the possible conformation of my polymer, and the number of states are approximated by using precisely the, let's say, the end-to-end distribution function, because that's a measure of the typical conformation of the size of your polymer, that I just derived before, namely by the Gaussian, okay? So, and if you take the logarithm of the Gaussian, so then you have that your entropy will be given by 3, okay, let's do it in the dimension, d r squared divided by n b, oh, I think there is a 2, yes. 2n b squared. And this quantity, so you can just take it, we can get rid of the prefactor. So it just took, so this is Flory. So that's the. Because, okay, you have to do something, I mean, a bit slower. So you take, so suppose that you ask, what is the number of states who have end-to-end distribution R, right? Right? So then that thing will be, so if you have, okay, let me write this. So that will be like exponential of minus, let's say, d r square, because I want to do it in the dimension, n b square, right? Then, you know, if I want the number of states, so I can multiply this by 4 pi r square d r, right?
because by definition, no? Or delta r if you want to keep it finite. I mean, some small r, right? But then, right? So then I can take it as a measure of, as an estimate of the entropy for the number of, so if I take the logarithm of this quantity, that's a measure of the entropy for the states, let's say, that have n to n distance r. Now you can say, okay, I have also this term, but this term, it's basically gross, actually goes like the logarithm of something, which is a power law of r, but it's always smaller than this one. Sorry, I can see. And then you can keep it just this one. It will not influence the rest of the stuff. It's a smaller term compared to this one. Okay, so that's the first approximation that Flori did. But if you have the states, no, it's plus, no? Let me see. Wait. No, it's a lot of the states. No, otherwise, no, it's, right? Okay. Okay. So then, yes, next term, which is a bit more difficult, but it's still simple. So, we need to determine a terms, we need to make a guess for the energy term related to the fact that there are all your monomers inside the space occupied by your polymer chains, and they interact, by pairwise interaction. So in order to derive this term, to give you a physical flavor, how to derive it in a simple way, I consider the following thing. Because this is a kind of good. No, I see your question. So this is. This is true. You can always. It's always defined up to a constant. So it's you can add any constant here. Yeah. So it's. Of course, this is defined. It's a free entropy, so it's defined up to a constant. So your friend is right. So it's. Okay. Let me first, because otherwise I don't know if I have enough time. So how we can estimate this quantity? So this quantity can be estimated. I give you a general derivation, and then we make an approximation. So I consider a very simple situation where I have pairwise interaction between monomers.
And we'll show you that this is perfectly acceptable in the case of the Flory theory for a polymer in a good solvent. So, in general, the repulsion can be written like this way. So, 1 half, the sum over n from 0 to capital N, and m from 0 to capital N of something Rn minus Rm. Okay, so this is a collection of all possible interaction, and I assume that they are pairwise, they are two-body interaction, okay? So now, this can be written also in this way, like sum n, sum n0 and n of the following quantity, v r vr minus r prime. Let me write this way: delta r minus r m delta r prime minus r m, and this is in dr in dr prime. Okay, so I just rewrote this by using Faruda. I just wrote it by. I mean, it's just a rewriting. I use just a delta function, nothing special. And now this function, okay, can be written. This formula can be written like 1 half the integral of vr minus vr prime, okay. And this is a generic expression for the potential. I stay generic. It's just a generic expression from two-body interaction with a polymer. I don't give it any specific shape. It will be just repulsive. Because in the end, I don't know how it's done. I mean, it's very complicated. But I assume that only, to a good approximation, can be described as a potential which is short range, zero, so namely zero at large distances, and let's say infinite if you want at short distance. And the short distance is the typical size of a monomer. Okay, this is a good approximation, but I keep it general. So this is a short-range expression for my potential. No, it's not exponential. It's really hardcore. Exponential for small distances. Yes. But I keep it just general. I mean, I don't want to be too specific. And so then, what I do, I move this thing out, and I write, so this will be like, dr prime, and then this will be like the sum n from 0 to n of delta r minus m and this r n. So this m equal to 0 delta r minus r m, the sum n 0 to n delta r prime minus r m. Wait, yes. This is m, and this is n, sorry. This is m, and this is n. The previous one, here. This is n, m, and this is m. Is it clear? No, I mean, because I want to arrive to this formula. So this is just the distribution, I mean, the density distribution of at position r, and this is the density distribution at position r prime of my monomers, let's say. Right? Is it, it's just, I mean, a rewriting. So this thing
Ah, sorry, it's I lost this VR. Sorry.
VR, VR prime, VR minus VR prime. So actually, this can be just rewritten.
I mean, it's blackboard, isn't it?
Because it's a bit. So this thing can be rewritten. Sorry if you can see from too far. So I write it here. So this thing can be written as 1 over half dr dr prime dr minus dr prime rho r prime. Sorry if I did this thing horrible, but I don't know how to write it. And this quantity, so this thing here,
if you want, it's just a double integral on the density of it's a double integral on the density distribution of my monomers. Okay. So now, suppose that. Suppose that this, as I told you, now this potential is short-ranged. So basically, you can approximate this like, a, I mean, for r equal r prime, if you want, like a delta function. Mm? So this is like 1 over half v0, where v0 is, or if you want, v0, this one. So it's the potential in 0. Suppose that you can keep it finite. I mean, you can do some... no, it's better this notation, V0. So namely, some constant, but I mean, where you keep this, short range, and this is, it survives just one integral for rho r square. Hmm? So this is just an approximation, okay? And but this is a good way that, in order to get an estimate for our energy, for the following reason, because now we can write this the energy in this way. Yes. So we can, let's say, get inspired by this shape, because this can be written like some constant, V0, the density of my polymer. By the density, I mean the density of the monomers, actually. By density of the monomers, I mean the density of the monomers in the space occupied by the polymers. So that will be like n r d square, because I have a square here, multiplied by, assuming that I take a sort of a mean field approximation, where this thing is, let's say, uniform, multiplied by the volume occupied by the polymer, because it's exactly the same expression as here. And I neglect prefactor. I just keep this V0, which has the dimension of a volume. And if you are familiar with, I don't know, the theory of gas or two body, this is proportional actually to the second virial coefficient. Okay? And so this is equal, if I do the calculation, it's V0 n squared divided by R over D, R to the power D.
And these are actually the two terms of the Flory derivation, because then I'm done. So I have an estimate, as you can see, it's a very simple term, which is proportional to, it's a two-body interaction term, plus the anentropy, or minus anentropy, if you want. So that two terms that I can put it here now, and derive, I mean, and if I, and now what I will do, I will just do a simple derivative, with respect to R, and then I will get, and I will put that to zero, and then I will get
the typical size of my polymer as a function of the number of monomers. Okay, so this will is equal to V0 n square divided up over D plus R square n V square. Okay, yes. Sorry? Yeah, yeah, it's the term here. But now you can see it's very simple.
Actually, we have made another approximation because we have used the formula for the PDF of the
Mm-hmm.
distance that we have derived for the random work.
Yes. Yes, yeah, yeah. We did two approximations. No, absolutely, I agree with you. So the first approximation is this one, and the second approximation is this one. And by some magic, these two approximations exactly cancel. These two approximations, there are two terms. I mean, we have neglected some terms that magically cancel each other. And now that I will do the minimization, I show you that the results that comes out is very good. So it's close to what would be the exact, let's say, more or less exact values. Hmm? Because now it's very easy. You can just, yes? I'm just going to finish this here, then, because otherwise, because I'm very tired, because I have to tell you also something about chromosomes. Sorry, otherwise I wouldn't understand. And then just do the derivation. It's I mean, a derivative, I think you can do it. I mean, it's very simple. So I do the derivative of F and R with respect to R. And tomorrow I will comment on these results. So if you do that, you get V0 n squared to, sorry, minus D R D plus 1 plus T to R divided by n d square. Okay.
yes.
Sorry, what?
What are we deriving
the free energy? Because I wanted the minimum of the free energy. Yeah. Ah, sorry, I thought it was obvious, sorry. Okay. Sorry? It's a trade-off, yeah, exactly. Yeah. So if I do that, then I get, again. Sorry, I will have RD plus 2 goes like n to the 3. And I just, to go faster, I just neglect the prefactor. I'm just interested in the exponent. Hmm? Which means that R goes like N3D plus 2, okay? Which means that my exponent nu is equal to 3D plus 2. So now you can appreciate the fact that the exponent I get is depending on the dimension. So it's completely different from what I had before. And you can see, you can specialize for the different dimension. So for instance, for D equal 1, nu is equal to 1, which according to you makes sense or not?
Yes.
I would say yes, no? Because this is a polymer with exclusive volume interaction, is completely stretched. So it's exact. It's what you would expect. In the end, in D equal 1 is trivial, the problem. But it's good that it gives the right exponent. So then you have D equal 2, which gives you an exponent which is 3 over 4, which, okay, this is not tremendously obvious, but it's also exact. And that was derived by, I think it was Duplantier, who derived the exact result for a polymer in two dimension with exclusive volume interaction. But these results, I mean, to derive exactly is quite complicated. say it's really technical, but it's good that, in some sense, with this simple theory, you get the exact result as well. Then you have in D equal 3, and this is really exact, it's really 3 over 4. Then in D equal 3, you have 3 over 5, and this is not exact in sense that the what is thought to be the true value is, so this is 3 over 5 is 0.6, what is thought to be the true value is 0.588, and it can be derived by using renormalization group. But it's quite remarkable. This approximate result is quite close. Right? And then in D equal 4, nu is equal 1 over 2. So, and tomorrow, okay, I will be more specific on that, but that means that in D equal 4, you get again the Gaussian behavior. And now just the last question. D larger than 4, what do you expect? Okay, it's of course smaller than 1/2. Good. Is it no equal? So that's not possible too? But you can simulate it. Yes. For D equal 1, 4, well, I will see it tomorrow more specifically because, of course, now it's late. But in D equal 4, larger than 4 means that excluded volume interactions are irrelevant. So simply, they exist, but they don't swell the polymer. Okay? That's related, if you want, to the encounter probability. Basically, the polymer never go back. It doesn't feel itself. But tomorrow I will show you that how to derive D equal 4 is the critical dimension for the Flory theory. And tomorrow I will show you how you can prove it a bit more rigorously. But also, already this is a piece of proof if you want. So sorry if I went too fast, but otherwise I can't tell you anything about chromosomes. So, yes.
About the entropy.
Yes.
We